So the only thing that there are not many things that join the experience of philosophers and the experience of journalists. One of them is that we ask questions. Then we are, we journalists know very much about our ignorance, but I know philosophers too, so as well. So we have a common experience about that. And my question is about what I understood of the notion of documentality is this, the following. Nothing social exists outside the text. We cannot perform social acts if they are not inscribed. In a way, my question is, does this give a huge importance to technology? I mean, if we only can perform social acts that we can inscribe, the technology that we are able to use and that exists is a sort of limit to what is possible. But if that is a correct question, and I need to tell you that I didn't know if it was an intelligent question, so I asked Professor Ferraris if I could asked that question, he said yes, so probably it's the right question. What does that mean? That technology is the limit of possible, of what is socially possible. I have some episodes or points of view about that. First episode. I'm in Naples, I'm a journalist, I go to have an interview with the local minister of economic life, and his name as a minister was pretty strange. He was called the minister to normality, assessore alla normalità. And the first line he said, the first phrase said, that the minister to normality, he said, Naples is a strange city. Which
is very normal sentence.
And then he had something that we already are used to think about Naples, but also many other cities, that in Naples, the red light, it's not an obligation, it's an advice. Why? Not because they don't follow the law, or they are criminals, or they don't want. They have another document. And the document is inscribed in the technology of the city. The city is difficult to ride with a car, and if the red light comes and nobody is there to pass on the other roads that cross that line, then they feel obliged to cross even if it is the red light. Because they have to go faster. There is a line behind them, and so they go. There is the red light, they don't disturb anybody, they go. And they go even if there is some body to disturb that's another question again. So the platform is the city, the technology is the city, the city gives an organization to traffic. Traffic is a sort of function that they have to perform, and they perform it by doing what I said. They go with the red light if they think that is better for the general interest. The second episode or something like that is asking somebody that works in financial markets about what he can do to improve the way financial markets have consequences to our life. It's clear from an Italian perspective, but not only that, the financial markets have their logic. That logic is a sort of document. It's inscribed in lots of computers. The way they perform their competition is by managing this set of computers that do the actual trading. And you know, the computers are so important that they manage to understand that they can win their trade if they are able to trade milliseconds before the others. That means that if the server that trader number one is in Milan, but the real trade is in London, those that work in London with their computers based in London, they win, because the time that comes from that is needed for a bit to go from Milan to London is milliseconds slower, so they don't perform the trade that they want to do. So, I mean, it's a giant robot that works the financial market, and no individual can really influence what happens on the market. Or at least that is an image of that. Third episode is the movie Matrix. They live in a document that is run by machines. Machines evolved in a way that they conquered power, and they use the energy that comes from humans for functioning, and to keep humans quiet, they convince them to live in a video game, which is a document. The reality those humans feel, think, to be in is the Matrix. That is a sort of image, of course, a fictional image, sort of, that it's a possible conclusion of one of the major ideas about technology. Technology evolves. Kevin Kelly says technology wants to become something. Brian Arthur talks about an evolution of technology. Technology follows its own rules. It's an evolutionary phenomenon that changes. So technology per se, it's a techno-technological change that changes what is possible to perform as a social act. I said I talk about these things because these are sort of extreme ways to tell what I wanted to say. There is a limit of what is socially possible, linked to technologies that we are able to use. We evolve those technologies. Technologies then influence the way we work. 1 minute. We are scared about technology that goes out of control, because we feel that that is something that influences a lot the way we possibly can socially act. That brings me to a conclusion, but conclusions from journalists are never interesting. And I underline that I just wanted raises the question that it has raised, which is technology the limit to what we are socially able to perform? But if I had to conclude something, I could conclude that we are in sort of a matrix that is social networks, platforms, and sort of many technologies that we are using every day for communicating, recording what we do and every other thing. That if we don't understand them completely, if we are not conscious enough, our intentional way to get together and socially perform acts that we really want to perform is limited.
Well, as you know, the philosophers of documentality don't want to talk about communication. They're talking about something else. So those kind of instruments, they are both for communicating and recording. And what happens to our brains, I don't know. Professor Legrenzi knows much better. But that's clear that what we use of the brain changes, right? So the synapses we have here, a company that is called Synapses, synapses, so I'll talk about that, change when we use them, when we are need to use a kind of memory that needs our analogical powers. We improve our memory capability in long term recording inside our brains. Of course, if we can rely on different strategy for memorizing, as you were saying before, then we change our abilities and the use of the same brain that we have since we were hunters. By the way, hunting was also using memory processes, because any weapon was also a recording of the knowledge of how to use it and everything. So there is nothing completely different. The real difference, as Professor Michelis was saying, is in to think about, at least, is in the digitalization. Because this is something that looks sort of different from any other thing. Or at least we are living in this age, so it seems to be very different from other historical moments. One thing that it clearly creates is that some parts of our memories or recording become so cheap that we think that they have no value, and we don't pay much attention to their form. But this creates a real consciousness of what where the real value is. And in the media sector, it's very clear that the value always goes where there is an interface with analogical life. So in the newspapers, it's clear that value has gone to from the technology that was owned by publishers to the other side, to the demand side. Because what is scarce now, what we don't have enough of, is the time of the public to read or to access to information. So time is analogical, it's inside us. We need time, like our life is our time. And that is analogical in time, in concrete time. Having the time of our public, we find the value of the interaction between media and people. And another thing, of course, is attention, which is Professor Analogic. I mean, it's us who create attention. It's not digital. Digital side is what is looking for us for attention. So the interaction between the digital boom and our still analogical life creates much more value on the side of the analog.
Also, it creates another couple of phenomena that I'm going to stop as Jamie tells me to. The art of memory, as we called it in different times, memorizing strategies with the help of Google and Wikipedia and those other things, means that we are giving some of our abilities, some of our sovereignty on a memory to something that is collectively created. So archives that are collectively created, like Wikipedia, Google, documents that we find through Google, give underline another change, that is the change of the growing importance of what somebody calls collective intelligence, or something that is about what we do together. And we didn't give too much thinking about how we develop collective intelligence, or what it is, whatever it can be called. But the fact is that we are giving some of our identity to a collective entity that has memory for us. So we will need to think about strategies for our identity. We need to still cultivate that, and those will be stories, projects, and experiments, but I could develop on that in another meeting. I can give you one example in the media center, using the fact that all the professional media confronts with social media and social networks that we were talking about before. So one of the major problems that professional media have with social media is about reliability, verification, and what they think is that they can, and me, I am part of that also, I'm part of both, so I can speak about both. Is that we are professionals, we are reliable, so trust us. Which is strange, because it's a self-definition. The real reliability is not me that I say I'm reliable. The real reliability is you say me I'm reliable. So how do we get there? On the other hand, on social networks, everybody can say whatever they want. I'm reliable and not reliable. They can say it because there is no professional definition of what they are doing. They are just doing what they want, and they have the right to do that. But when there will be a link, a small link between professional and non-professional use of the media to grow information that we can rely on, is the moment in which we sort of take responsibility and declare with a document that we share some responsibility. My example, and I finish, is right now has happened, so I can tell you as news, that we have launched this service that we call Timu. It's a Swahili word to say Timu. Timu comes from a foundation that is called Aref. It's about quality of information and social networks. And I will not tell you how it works, but it works exactly in the line that you were talking about. It's open source, nobody owns the content, and it's only the author who owns the content. Even the URL you can own if you use that kind of platform. And to use it, you just declare a methodology that you follow when you create information. Information meaning in the terms of the newspaper experience, information is something that is news that can be used by the public, and it's on the side of the public, while communication is on the side of the source of information, of the messages. So there is no constraint, no obligation, no contract, but when you use it, you declare that you will be accurate, independent, you will be transparent with the conflict of interest, you will verify your interviews. And you just declare that.
You can declare I'm factious, I'm Republican, I'm...
If you don't declare that kind of document, you cannot do it.
Okay.
That's all. And of course you can live without it very well. But if you want to participate in the team, we declare that kind of thing. You just show that you do information with that simple, very understandable and shareable definition of what is factual information is. If you participate, then you can participate to contests, you can win prizes, you can share your information with others, you can create groups and create a growing group and become more important. Every move you do on Timo will be assessed by the others, so your reputation will change in time, and you will have a reputation that is also transparent to the others. But you own your content, you own your URL, you own your profile, you use an open source thing, and you declare a sort of standard responsibility document about the way you do information.
Well, if you define identity as being me and not something, somebody else, which is part of identity, then what I understand is that the best way to see if that's me and not somebody else seems to be to connect me to my phone, portable phone number. What does that mean? It means that I'm me, I'm recognizable as me. If I'm the node, the only node possible node to the network of friends that I have, and most importantly, to the behavior that I showed and recorded during the whole time that I used my phone. And if you add to that the way you use your credit cards, your other interaction with different networks, then you are the only possible node to the network that usually has that kind of behavior. So when you have a credit card and somebody buys something in Uganda with your credit card, and you usually don't go in Uganda, then your bank calls you and says, there is somebody using your credit card. That's the kind of idea. So your identity is being what you usually are in relationship to the network or different sort of networks that you use. This is part of my identity. Yeah, the most part is my story, my biography, what I have inside. And that is something that we are looking to define and show and be recognized on different domains like social networks. That's why we need those. But we are very at the beginning of what we can do with that.